So hello everybody, welcome to our Elmarco talks. Actually, this is fantastic that you are continuously with us, that you are following us, and actually for your interest today, we have more than 250 followers, which is great. And so I will jump right to the topic of today. Today we're going to touch medical application field. Actually, to be honest, we had just returned from the Medica show trade event, which was great, and we got a lot of inputs and a lot of great ideas, which really convinced us that nanofibers has the role, important role in the medical segment, especially because they greatly mimic the extracellular matrices, and there are a lot of possibilities where the nanofibers can be used in the medical segment. I'd like to remind you next sessions, which are actually coming soon because December is very short. And we have next session on December 12th, which is going to be very special because we have a guest from industrial segment, and we're going to talk about nanofiber filters. Next session is right after the new year, so it's going to be first in 2024, end of January. It's from the research group, and also interesting topic about the functional membranes for water and energy technologies. So this is for the beginning. And shortly introducing our today's speaker is Yulia Higuchi. I will maybe talk about her work and the background in a short minutes, because first of all, I would like to mention something more about Elmarco. Elmarco is, of course, the organizer of these talks and is a global leader of installing, implementing, producing, and selling the nanospider technology, which is based on the electrospinning method. We are the global company delivering in almost every corner of the world, and we are here for more than 20 years, which still surprising us that in some sectors, especially the medical sector, there are not so many people that are aware actually of existing of Elmarco. And we are really happy that this, let's say, the field is coming, and we will, you know, can contribute to development of nanofibers, in, especially in this medical segment. So nanofiber technology, how does it work? So we are using the wire as a spinning electrode. Basically, the wire is connected to high voltage power supply, which brings the energy to the whole system. On the wire, the wire is being coated with polymeric solution, and the fibers are generated from the wire and they are coming to the collector, which is usually placed on the top of the system. And in the between, there is always any like carrier or substrate which is running through the spinning chamber, and nanofibers are being coated, deposited right up on the surface of this moving carrier. So that's the principle of the nanospider. And now this is a little overview about the machinery that we are producing. So first of all, there is the smallest electrospinning device, 30 centimeter wide electrode, still talking about the wire as the electrode, the width, which is determining the size of the machine. And then the half meter size of the machine, which is a little bit bigger, a little bit more sophisticated. And then the everything is leading actually to the big technology package, I would say, which covers not only the nanospider, but also other peripherals, which are very important to form the entire key solution for making production of making nanofibers in a big scale. Today, I like to encourage you to pay attention on our recent upgrade of the machine, which is a half meter size machine, which I mentioned previously. And what is new about it? We're trying that this machine is more dedicated to the medical segment because it's a not the smallest one, but also not the biggest one. We think it's the right size for making reasonable quantities of medical material. And we are actually upgrading this machine with two more electrodes. So in total, this machine now has three wires in the width of 0.5 meter. And we are adding a little bit more features, more benefits, let's say, to this machine in form of a possibility to make different structure. So if you see, the picture is pointing to the rotating electrode, which is great for making aligned fibers. Although you're making very small samples, still you see maybe more than 80, even like 90% of alignment of the fibers. And the next feature is the endless belt collecting electrode, which enables to work with more materials which are less conductive. So for example, now you can coat more materials similar to foils, maybe polyesters, which are highly non-conductive materials. So it's actually more versatile machine, which we are now currently introduced. And I would be really happy to answer you any question on this machine later on, not in this session, but if you contact us individually. And now, okay, summarizing the nanofiber application, I think that's very obvious. Still need to remind that our biggest segment is the air filtration, still selling the most of the technology, the big lines, which you see to the air filtration segment. But there are other segments which are coming, which is liquid filtration, energy, and of course, medicine. And medicine is the topic of today, and it covers really broad area and enormous possibilities for nanofibers in wound care segment, tissue engineering, drug release, and surgical drapes and face mask, of course. All right, so now it's the time when I would like to introduce you the speaker of today, who is Julia Higuchi. She's working at the Polish Academy of Science in Warsaw, Poland. And her topic of today will be electrospinning and ultrasonic coating of fibers with nanoparticles, and of course, in the medical application. So Julia has graduated from actually two universities, Medical University of Warsaw and Warsaw University of Technology. And she also gained the title MBA from university in US. And she's been busy with the electrospinning fight for some time. Is very energetic and enthusiastic woman and the researcher. So she's also working on the material surface modification, which is the topic of today. And I hope you will benefit from this presentation, and we all looking forward to it. So please, Julia, the stage is yours.
Thank you again for this kind introduction. Also, thank you for giving me this great opportunity to share my research with you. So, as I was introduced already by the host of this Elmarco talks, I work for Laboratory of Nanostructures in Institute of High Pressure Physics in Poland, and my talk today will be more about the method of modification of various electrospun fibers, but also different structures for medical applications, mainly for tissue engineering. But let me go into the details. Maybe I'll introduce my institute a bit, because where high pressure physics meets medical field, it may be quite interesting for some of you. Our institute is recognized worldwide, mainly for its unique expertise in fundamental and applied studies in the field of semiconductors, superconductors, soft matter, terahertz physics, but among them also high quality research on biomaterials. and I represent a laboratory of nanostructures, which is specializing mainly in the fabricating of different nanomaterials and also using them for manufacturing different medical devices. So our lab for nearly 25 years now, it's working on high pressure technologies. We started as designers of microwave reactors and manufacturers of medical nanoparticles of high purity. These microwave reactors, I will go into the detail into their technology maybe later, but we can produce nanoparticles of very specific narrow particle size. We can characterize them according to ISO standards in our lab. And we're also using them for fabricating coatings by ultrasonic force. I will be focusing on that topic today. But also we can use nanoparticles for high pressure forming, for fabricating bulk implants like bone fixation screws and plates. Since 2022, we also produce nano biomaterials in cleanroom facilities according to ISO 13485 norm, which I'll maybe explain later. So when it comes to microwave synthesis of nanoparticles, as I already mentioned, we are a producer of various nanoparticles, and it's a natural route for us to use them for different technologies. Our main interest is focused on bone regeneration, and thus we produce nanohydroxyapatite materials mainly. They are nanohydroxyapatite is actually a material which naturally occurs in human bones. That's why this is a natural way of using it for bone regeneration biomaterials. The synthesis of nanohydroxyapatite in microwave reactors, it's based on the heating of the reaction vessel in all the volume at the same time, which results in producing very small nanoparticles. And as you can see, the example of sizes, they are of a very specific size, defined size. And this size matters in terms of using such materials for even in human body for different bone reconstructions. Like for example, dental reconstruction devices, they will need different nanoparticles. The long bones in orthopedics will need different nanoparticles. Our interest in such nanoparticles and coatings made of such started somewhere around 2010, when we were part of a very interesting project called Bioimplant. The project concerning the reconstruction of big defects in a jaw bone of a patient after removing some oncological tumors, cancerous tissues. The project was based on 3D printing technology, and our task was to produce hydroxyapatite to somehow blend with the material for 3D printing to fabricate the implant, which will be more biocompatible than just the polymer itself. So in such a project, the tailor-made implant was fabricated using our hydroxyapatite and 3D printed together with the biopolymer. But at some point of our research, we focused on not mixing hydroxyapatite in a standard way with the within bulk implants, but to fabricate very thin coatings of hydroxyapatite on the implant's surface. So the methods which we used, or actually we patented the method, is based on the phenomena of ultrasonic cavitation, which is occurring in liquids subjected to ultrasonic waves. And in such a solution, or even in the water subjected to ultrasounds, we observe a formation of cavitation bubbles, which are bubbles of gas subjected to acoustic pressure cycles. They grow and shrink within time, and after exceeding a certain energy, they collapse in the liquid. And such implosion of bubbles is calling a major shock wave. And what we're using in this method is actually this shock wave of collapsing bubble. The patent itself and the describing of this ultrasonic coating method is based on submerging an object to be coated in a solution of nanoparticles subjected to ultrasonic waves. So as I mentioned, the formation of those cavitation bubbles in each liquid, when we have nanoparticles in such solution and the bubble is collapsing near the surface of the material, we observe a very delicate but quite homogeneous deposition of nanoparticles. And this method, normally we would think that ultrasounds would destroy the surface of materials, but by controlling the parameters of such deposition, we can coat even very, very thin electrospun fibers. And I will mention about this maybe, but you can see that also other materials can be coated, like titanium, glass, different polymeric meshes. What is interesting for this method, and we explored it in various projects, is that even such thin layer of 200 up to 500 nanometers can create such an environment for tissues, especially bone tissue, that we observe a major new bone tissue growth surrounding such implants after being implanted into the bone. We noticed that in case of simple polymeric 3D printed implants, we observed over 30 to 40% more bone volume just by applying such thin layer. These are examples of such deposited layers on the bulk implants. The upper image shows the 3D printed polymer scaffold. The lower image shows the ceramic scaffold. You can see very discrete coating without changing the porosity of the implant. As an example of coating of electrospun fibers, you can see that nanoparticles in such process, they penetrate the implant and cover each fiber, but without leaving big agglomerates, let's say, of nanoparticles. On this slide, you can see an example of a patent we submitted and we actually obtained in 2022. It's an example of fibrous structure made out of biodegradable polymers, coated with nanohydroxyapatite to obtain a membrane for tissue separation and dental applications. To show you maybe even in details, like how the coating is, how detailed the coating is, maybe you can see the scanning electron microscopes of single fibers. They are very nicely coated from each side. The coating is quite homogeneous. We can obtain up to 10 to 15% of coating, let's say, by weight in the whole implant, which means that quite a lot of nanoparticles can be deposited within the structure. Such coatings, they are interesting because, first of all, they increase the specific surface area of the materials, which also affects the water absorption, the hydrophilicity. It's a very important function for biomaterials because they can be more adaptable by human tissues after implantation. And also it's a very important feature for cells to grow. Here in this slide, you can see the response of fibroblastic and also osteoblastic cells on such coating materials. We proved that the attachment of cells, it's much better, and the growth of cell is increased in such on such structure. Such membranes were already used in various applications so far in veterinary medicine, because as I will mention maybe later, the human medicine requires much more biotesting. In this case study, the membrane, the biodegradable membrane, was used for reconstruction of sports horse bone to separate the soft tissues from bone and somehow support the regeneration. The membrane was absorbed within 3 months without a trace, and it fulfilled its function. Another feature characteristics of this method is that we can apply layer by layer of nanoparticles. We can use particles of different features. For example, in this slide, you can see bone stimulating hydroxyapatite layer and the zinc oxide with silver antibacterial layer, which as a result is killing bacteria, but also supporting the cell's growth. And as I was showing before, we also observed highly increased wettability of such samples. Currently, we upgraded our technology to our cleanroom facilities. We use the NS Lab device of Elmarco in cleanroom. It seems like a lab scale device, but for such application, it's so far enough for us, but maybe in the future we can scale up the technology. For now it's limited because of the space of cleanroom. We have a certain amount of space we cannot exceed for now, but the technology in the cleanroom was let's say mastered to in the small scale to obtain the ISO certification for medical product manufacturing. And this is a product for guided tissue regeneration application in dentistry. It's a membrane coated with nanohydroxyapatite. This is how the setup looks like. The setup for electrospinning, as I mentioned, is NS Lab. We use the the feature of moving the substrate of made out of spun bond, but at a very low speed to obtain very thick membranes for our standards, which is around half a millimeter to 1 millimeter thickness. When it comes to ultrasonic coating, we use the device with the two rotating bars to coat the membrane in the form of 30 centimeters long strap, which is later cut and dried and sterilized by gamma radiation. So apart from the manufacturing of those membranes in the clean room, we also produce nanohydroxyapatite as a powder in a powder form for direct filling in bone defects. It's already used in veterinary medicine. And also we provide services of sonocoating different structures such as titanium implants or depending on the industry partners, it can be a different form of electrospun material as well. I already mentioned that the material coated with hydroxyapatite is used in veterinary medicine, but it's important to mention that it's already undergoing biocompatibility testing for human use. So we're at the stage of implantation and currently with one of the industrial partners, we're applying for funding for clinical trials on humans. So we're expecting that the material may reach the market in 2027, maybe 2029. So it's a very long process. As you can see, since the patenting of a design and the patenting of the method of modification. So what we can offer to industrial and scientific partners is that we can characterize the materials, nanomaterials with the certified method, methods. We can synthesize various nanopowders and hydroxyapatite, especially according to ISO norms. We provide the coating services, scientific expertise in various fields, and we are looking for different project partners as a scientific institution, various industrial partners, and different collaborators in the commercialization of medical products. So I will also share this information with the hosts of our meeting, but here you have also contact information in case of collaboration or
further questions.
So thank you for your attention.
I just want to mention, because I didn't mention it in the beginning, and it's my fault. So next to me is Carolina. She's a marketing leader of Elmarco. She's a marketing specialist, and she's been always been behind the scene. So today is the first time where you actually see the engine of the motor of the whole webinars. So she's, you know, responsible for these great, you know, opportunities that we are giving to our presenters. And she's today to run the Q&A session with me.
Exactly. Thank you very much. Katarina works in sales and customer support as a manager. So we will continue with discussion part. Julia, thank you very much for this interesting presentation. And I will open the discussion part with my question. And that's what are the material limitation of ultrasonic coating?
The material limitations, I mean the material to be coated, yes. So as I maybe forgot to mention at the beginning, the process of ultrasonic coating, it's performed in the maybe slightly elevated temperature, more than room temperature, but it never exceeds 30 centigrades. But nevertheless, all the materials to be coated, they should be maybe resistant to up to this temperature. And also, as the coating is formed in the aqueous media, the material should not dissolve immediately in the water. So, but apart from that, all range, the whole range of materials, from aliphatic polyester, ceramics, glass, even natural polymers like hyaluronic acid fibers, they can be coated. We proved that in our research. So.
Mm-hmm. Thank you.
There's a question from audience, and actually a very interesting one. So how scalable is the ultrasonic coating method? I noticed you mentioned that you are using 30 centimeter long strip for the for the coating, like a bath. So how could you imagine, for example, somebody is doing that roll-to-roll production to be, you know, applied directly behind or after the electrospinning, let's say, in one raw, or how do you see the difficulties of this?
So far it's as I mentioned, probably the limitation is on our side, because we're not production engineers, but definitely the technology can be scalable for using like roll to roll and rolling with a certain speed the material underneath the source of ultrasounds. When we're coating the materials currently, it takes up to 5 minutes of deposition to get the homogeneous coating. So the moving of a substrate with the material should be relatively slow at this point, but I think it's just a challenge for the production engineers to scale up.
Great, thank you. From the same person, actually. How deep can your coating go into the nanofiber mesh, or is it actually covering just the surface? I think you had some pictures on your presentation to see that it's just the coating, but how deep the particles can get into the mesh?
As to give you an example, like we're not only coat the electrospun materials, but when we're coating bulk implants, they can be of 5 centimeters thickness, and they are homogeneously coated inside. So in case of electrospun membranes, the deposition is quite homogeneous on each side of a material, and we proved that it's not a problem that the ultrasonic devices, for example, placed above the electrospun material only, because the ultrasonic cavitation occurs in the whole volume of the liquid. So also from the bottom, the material is penetrated with the cavitation bubbles, and that's why we have this homogeneous coating everywhere.
Okay, I have another question. What is the stability of the product?
Of the membrane with hydroxyapatite?
Yeah, that's how I understand this question. Yeah, what is the lifetime, or how long?
So the materials we produce according to the ISO standards, they have, after gamma sterilization, they have a shelf life of 2 years. If they are kept, they are sealed and vacuum packed, and this is the proven shelf life so far.
And I think there's the next question which is related to that. So the adhesion of hydroxyapatite to fibrous surface? Mm-hmm. Because that's basically the shelf life, maybe over the whole composite you're talking about, or do you observe any delamination or any, you know, separation, let's say, of these nanohydroxyapatite coating from the fibers or from any surface?
So this is also an interesting topic for our scientific research, but in case of electrospun membranes, we did not see the delamination of the layer, because you could see on the images, the layer is rather thin. So we're not trying to create such a layer which will be cracking because of the increased thickness. And we noticed that when the material coated with hydroxyapatite is subjected to stretching, for example, the nanoparticles are still staying. It's, as you could imagine, a sand being stuck to a chewing gum. It's just still there. It's just still there, but it's stretching together with the material.
Yeah, because it's important, I think, in terms of, you know, releasing the nanoparticles into the environment. So maybe that's the question, like how the mechanical stress can influence, you know, separation or anything. But you mentioned that it's stable, it's fixed there.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Okay, I have maybe a question of myself here. I put here. So you mentioned you make the nanofibers out of the PLGA polymer. So what is any particular reason of selecting this polymer, or can be the nanofibers together with the, you know, hydroxyapatite nanoparticles be, for example, from PCL, polycaprolactone? Mm-hmm. Or any other biodegradable, let's say, polymers?
Yeah, so as I mentioned, this particular membrane patented for periodontal applications, it's composed of PDLA and PLGA because of mechanical properties, biodegradation rate, and other desired properties for this application. But when it comes to electrospinning and ultrasonic coating, as I mentioned, all of the aliphatic polyesters are fine. Maybe only the materials which would instantly degrade in the aqueous media could be a problem.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. Thank you. Okay, next one.
We can take another question from the audience. Could you explain again how the nanoparticles adhere to the surface during the coating? How do you achieve a uniform coating over the whole membrane surface? And if you need to move the ultrasonic horn around the bus? So there are three questions from one attendee. We can go through one after each other.
Yeah, basically all related on, again, explanation, how is the technology applied, you know, in reality? How does it work?
So when it comes to the mechanism of deposition, as I mentioned, the nanoparticles, when they are in vicinity of such collapsing bubble, they will be taken with the, let's say, water jet created by the implosion of such bubble, and they will start penetrating the material. And some of them will, of course, leave the porosity of the material, but most of them are staying on the surface of the fibers. How we control the homogeneously obtained coating, it's also, it was a matter of many studies. We observed that when we initially use the ultrasounds for just a few seconds, we see only the islands of nanoparticles scattered on the fibers, and with the longer process of deposition, those gaps are filled to get a homogeneous coating. So it's a matter of choosing the right length of a process depending on the material.
And there's a question, what is actually the major need for such a coating? But I think you already mentioned that it helps, that it gives the kind of mechanical strength, and then hydroxyapatite is natural being, provided in the bones already of the human. But maybe if you can comment shortly on that. So what is actually the need for this coating? How does the coating helping, you know, this material?
So in general, if you think about all the nanoparticles, use all different kinds of nanoparticles, I think the most important finding of this describing of this technology is that we can have nanoparticles of certain properties and we can deposit them on the surface of materials without losing those properties. So, for example, we're taking antibacterial nanoparticles, which are very have a very strong antibacterial properties, and the material coated with those nanoparticles will still have these properties. The same with the bone regenerative nanoparticles like hydroxyapatite. This is important because there are many methods of obtaining coatings on biomaterials, and some of those methods they change the properties of a coating. We studied the materials before and after coating, also the nanoparticles in the form of powder and then in the form of coating, if there was any change within the process, like chemical changes occurring, and we proved that there is no change. Because the process is conducted for a short time in a low temperature in a water-based media.
Thank you. Could you maybe pick another question?
Yes. So another question from audience. How do you keep your clean room actually clean while doing nanoparticles coating within the facility?
That's interesting.
So this clean room is of this ISO 7 and 8 standard. So the amount of particles in the air in the clean room are strictly monitored. The good thing about this technology is that when we're fabricating nanoparticles, they can be taken, let's say, from the synthesis reactor already in a liquid suspension. So we never have nanoparticles in a dry form in a clean room. Also, the clean room itself, it's got the good HEPA filtration systems. There is a exchange of air several times per hour, and when it comes to like a microbiological cleanliness of the clean room, we have we're strictly monitoring the microbial growth. Let's say we have tests quite often. We test the surfaces, everything we touch, it's tested, so we know there is no contamination in the process.
Did we have actually a question, two very similar questions, whether self-assembled nanoparticles can be prepared, used the ultrasonic coating methods, which I cannot imagine how. So maybe it's related to, just how you create these nanoparticles, if that can be done by the ultrasonic coating itself, just particle itself.
Yeah, so this ultrasonic cavitation, let's say this phenomena, was firstly used just for synthesis of nanoparticles in the liquid in situ. This was reported several years ago. So you could synthesize nanoparticles and immediately deposit them on the material, or you could use a powder suspended in the water and then deposit nanoparticles. So this is possible.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. Oh, is this the same? Maybe this one.
Is there any particular frequency range to operate ultrasonication as the ultrasonication at certain frequency could disrupt the nanofiber structure?
So as I was showing on the one slide, we are operating in such a range of ultrasounds, which is very low. This is very low frequency ultrasounds, around 18 kilohertz to 20 kilohertz. And if you go up within this range, of course, you would see some destructive force working on the material. But since we're operating at this border between acoustic waves and ultrasounds, let's say ultrasound starts from like 20 kilohertz up, so we're avoiding any destruction of a material.
Thank you.
Maybe I ask another question from our side. How is it actually possible that such a strong ultrasonic force is not destructive for the materials to be coated?
I think we just mentioned it's related to the frequency, maybe, that you just mentioned. And is there any other aspect of it?
Very close to the ultrasonic, let's say, sonotrode, there is a bit of increase of temperature. So we shouldn't put it like also too close to the material. There is a certain distance we should keep from the material to have an active cavitation, but not melting the material.
Thank you. It's interesting you mentioned you are working in a fully certified clean room. So my question would be related to that. So you mentioned that you are open to collaboration with, you know, external partners. So for example, because we as Elmarco are getting sometimes requests for production of material in the clean room. So my question, would it be possible on your side, I mean, to do such a services for people that just interesting, they have their own recipe, let's say their own material, they want to electrospin some material in the clean room. So are you open to that?
So of course we have a production line used for, as I mentioned, those medical use membranes. But if the material proposed by some industrial partner, for example, is not somehow toxic to the, there is no contamination we can introduce, then we're open for collaboration, of course. So it's a matter of discussing about the materials.
Understand. Okay, so maybe question here. So what type of nanoparticles can be actually used for this method? Apart from already mentioned. So what is the specific of these nanoparticles, like any other than hydroxyapatite?
So we use so far many different types of nanoparticles, not only for medical use. And the only limitation we found was the size of nanoparticles. It should not exceed 70, 80 nanometers, because then the coating would not be so homogeneous. Of course, it's possible to deposit nanoparticles, but then we will have a different outcome. We tested micro particles as well, the hydroxyapatite and microform, and it was successful, but the structure wasn't so homogeneous. It's just because of the size of particles. Maybe also the same limitation as for substrate material to be coated, that nanoparticles used for deposition, they should not react somehow with this aqueous media.
And yeah, you're talking about substrate. You mean either nanofibers or any other implants, right?
Yes.
Okay. And you mentioned the thickness of the either nanofiber membrane. You're talking about really thick membrane, right? Like 0.5 millimeter, even like 1 millimeter. Why is that? Can we work also with thinner materials?
Yeah, of course. We proved that it's possible even with much thinner membranes. They are not destroyed by the force. It's just a matter of finding the right distance and the parameters of the process.
Mm-hmm. Understand.
So I will took another question from audience. Sometimes ultrasonic probes themselves can be damaged by cavitation and particulates. Do you see any wear on your ultrasonic probes themselves?
Mm-hmm. So the setup we have for the clean room and also the lab scale setup for ultrasonic coating, the sonot rod, the actual object responsible for creating this ultrasonic wave, it's usually made out of titanium. There is of course a minor wear of the sonot rod, but so far we proved that when you're maintaining the equipment well, and after several series of deposition of nanoparticles, you for example polish the surface of the sonot rod, then you're avoiding any contamination. We also proved it in no toxicity in vitro and in vivo tests on animals, so there is nothing unusual in the materials. We performed a very detailed chemical analysis post-production, so we would see if there is any titanium somehow on the surface of material.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. Another interesting question. So it's related to either hydrophilicity or hydrophobicity. So can you somehow tune the material to be either hydrophilic or hydrophobic just by applying these nanoparticles or any particular tip of nanoparticles that can be used for either hydrophilicity or hydrophobicity?
So since we're using those hydrophilic nanoparticles themselves, like hydroxyapatite itself, also because of the size is very hydrophilic and also chemical structure, we were increasing the hydrophilicity by applying the coating. I think if we would use the nanoparticles, which are somehow introducing the hydrophobic nature to the material, it would be more visible when coating flat surfaces, not fibers, because fibers, you know, as I mentioned, the specific surface area of fibers is the main factor of increasing the hydrophilicity, not only the chemical structure of the particles.
Okay. Do we have any more questions?
Yes. This one.
Whether is there any effect in degradation of the biomaterials? I don't know in how the author mean that question, effect in degradation. Maybe if you observe or you did study some, you know, degradation of biomaterials used in that composite.
Mm-hmm. So we were studying, for example, the change of molecular weight of the material before and after the coating process. But since the process is so short and it's only in the low temperature, we did not see a major change. Mm-hmm. Also, as I mentioned, mechanically the material was not the mechanical properties were not lowered somehow after the process. of course, if we're using biopolymer, which is undergoing quite fast hydrolysis, maybe the somehow the hydrolysis can start during this process, but we did not prove any major changes in degradation afterwards. And
I have maybe one of the last question related to the picture or the slide you showing you were helping the horse with the with the healing during some surgery, healing the bones. So how long does it take? I mean, could you say that the combination, let's say nanofibers or whatever substrate in hydroxyapatite, let's say nanoparticles, will have faster healing? Or what is the time, let's say, needed? Or what is the benefit in time, let's say?
Yeah, so in this very application, the presence of nanoparticles was mainly helping the bone tissue to regenerate after the cracking of a bone. Since the bone needs some certain time amount of time to heal the bone tissue, of course, this is only a temporary help. This is not a long-term implantable screw like titanium or some slowly degrading polymer. But in this case, as the doctors mentioned, the separation from the soft tissue, not to somehow get irritated by the sharp pieces of bone. This was the protection they were looking for.
Great. Thank you. I mean, there are no more questions from audience, but I'm sure if the questions are coming later on, we will definitely, transfer it on to you, or they may contact you directly, of course. Yeah, thank you very much again. It was very interesting, and I think for everybody, for me, and I believe Carolina as well. Yeah, so let's see each other again in December. Thank you, Julia, very much. For the everybody, for the audience, thank you again for joining us, for following us, and we are looking forward to the next session on December 12th.
Thank you very much, and see you soon.
Okay, thank you. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.